The SAS is the Special Forces regiment upon which all others are based. Few are tough enough to pass selection. But what does it take to survive once you make it into the Special Air Service? Using a series of dramatic scenarios, a team of hardened ex-SAS veterans have agreed to reveal the survival secrets that kept them alive. The commander of our four-man patrol is former SAS Sergeant Eddie Stone. With him is demolitions expert John McAleese, the first man on the balcony in the Iranian embassy siege. Additional firepower and expertise is provided by Johnny and Pete. We've had to protect their identities. Together, they'll show you how members of the world's most elite regiment fight and survive, and reveal just what it takes to wear this badge. In this episode of SAS Survival Secrets, we reveal how our elite four-man team provides close protection to a VIP on foot.
Charlie, one strong, move the pickup, over.
And what happens when their principal is kidnapped and taken hostage? How will she survive? Our SAS team return in counter-terrorist mode, and we find out how they plan and mount an immediate action rescue mission. Last time on SAS Survival Secrets, Eddie Stone and his team were given a new fictitious mission, bodyguarding a British minister on a foreign trip. After receiving intelligence confirming the minister to be a target for a known terrorist group, the team went through the essential kit, training and planning needed for high-level close protection.
Contact front!
Phase two of the mission involved escorting the minister to the British Embassy. Along the way, Eddie and the team demonstrated the potential threat faced by the VIP when traveling by car.
Get down! Get down!
British Minister Long and her press aide begin the first leg of their fictitious tour of Mostovia. They are flanked by our SAS close protection team, who over the next 24 hours will escort the minister on foot. Miss Long likes to be seen amongst the public, and she dislikes overt security.
I don't want too much bodyguarding. I want to get out there and meet the people.
Having made the necessary threat assessment, Eddie Stone and the close protection team have opted for a low-key, overt approach. They wear civilian clothing, but carry concealed weapons. Let's break down the team's command structure and look how it maintains all-round defense. The four-man team is led by Eddie Stone, who assumes the role of bodyguard, or BG. The role of BG is to be the closest member of the team to the VIP. He is at the center of the various circles of protection provided by the rest of the team. His job is not to fight, but to provide immediate body cover to the minister by issuing strong verbal commands to the rest of the team. He usually works within an arm's length from his boss. The BG assumes the team leader role and liaises with the minister over itinerary. In reality, he practically lives with the VIP. For most of the time, he needs to keep a low profile, and to the untrained eye, he should be impossible to spot in the role he occupies. The three remaining members of the close protection team make up the personal escort section. They are a visible deterrent and play a major factor in the prevention of an assassination or kidnap attempt. The PES provides protection by being alert and observant. They are constantly using their eyes to assess the changing situations around the VIP. The close protection team needs to decide the level of overt or covert protection given to the VIP. This is usually threat and image dependent. In our fictitious scenario, first stop on the British minister's tour of Mostovia is a meeting with President Goran. He rules his country through a combination of heavy-handed police tactics and dubious free elections. He's keen to welcome Minister Long in order to continue receiving British financial and military aid. President Goran is also never one to miss a photo opportunity. The British minister and the close protection team come face to face with their first unexpected press pack of the day.
Why have you come to this country? What are your plans for the week?
Well, we've had long negotiations with the Moldovan prime minister during the last year. I've come on a fact-finding mission to see how the financial aid that my country is giving to Moldova is being used.
For the close protection team, the press pack poses more of a nuisance than security threat. But vigilance is needed in case of any unwanted intruders posing as the press.
And what are your plans for the rest of today, Minister?
Today, we have a short meeting with the Prime Minister, then I intend moving south into the rural areas.
How seriously do you take threats to your safety?
No threat at all. I have got my own security people with me, and I've been assured by your president that I can move freely around your country. Thank you. If that is all, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Goodbye.
By revealing her itinerary to the international press, Minister Long has left herself vulnerable to a possible terrorist attack. Eddie, as her assigned bodyguard, needs to make her aware of the security lapse. But this does not go down well with the minister.
I told you it's imperative that I have the freedom to move around this country, get to the rural areas and to meet the people, and that is what I'm going to do.
Nobody's denying you that, Minister. All I'm saying to you is you did not have to announce it to the press. Anybody who's trying to or planning an operation against you now knows your movements over the next few days. I don't think that was very wise, and I will be making a report to
that. I will not be dictated to.
I'm not dictating
to you,
Minister.
You've made your point.
Thank you. I am here to give you advice.
You've made your point. Thank you. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister.
Under their suits, all the close protection team are kitted out with a range of awesome firepower. Intense training and well-rehearsed drills mean that our protection team will only draw their weapons if they feel an armed attack is about to take place on the VIP or themselves.
When operating in a close protection team, it's an individual's choice as to how he carries his weapon. As long as he can get that weapon out quickly and into use, then there's no problem. I personally prefer a hip draw because I feel it is quicker. OK, let's have a look at John Mack. John Mack's wearing a cross draw. Not because he prefers it, because in this case, he's got an MP5 Kurtz on the right-hand side of his body. Obviously, if his pistol was on the same side as his MP5 Kurtz, it may impede his action to pull the weapon out quickly and efficiently. Let's have a look at Johnny. Johnny's wearing a standard issue shoulder holster. In this case, he's wearing it because he's a driver and he's easier access to get his weapon out rather than have it around his hip when he's sitting in his seat. Finally, let's have a look at Pete. Pete's wearing a standard hip draw, as preferred by myself, access to the weapon very quick. Pete also carries an ankle holster as a backup weapon. If he has a stoppage with his main weapon, he can get down, pull out his backup weapon, and engage the target. Very simple.
So what if the British minister was about to come under an armed attack? How would our close protection team react? The team have immediate action drills for any given situation, which allow them to react instantly with speed, power, and accuracy. Remember, a VIP is most vulnerable to attack when on foot. The enemy can strike at any time and without warning, especially when the VIP and the close protection team are in unfamiliar surroundings.
Charlie 2, move for pickup, over. The minister is on walkabout. Johnny is a lead man. He immediately spots a sniper on the roof. He will start drawing his weapon. We will instantly react to that. Johnny will start putting the fire down. Pete will be doing exactly the same, as will Johnny and Mike. My role in this case is to get the VIP into cover as soon as possible. The rest of the team will follow me. One of them going to the left, where there's a gap in the wall. Johnny, who will start putting down more fire.
On the roof, on the roof! Cover and fire!
John Mike will stay with me. He's there to cover me in case anything happens on the opposite side of the road. Pete will move to the right-hand side of the wall. Once we're in position, I will then instruct the bodyguarding team to take out this assassin. At this time, the terrorist, or the assassin, is now being engaged from two different positions. And any time he comes up to engage the target, he's exposing himself to the other member of the close protection team, who eventually take him out. While this is happening, I am on the radio, back to the vehicles, instructing them to come up to pick us up.
While travelling to the rural areas of Mostovia, Minister Long, true to form, decides to make a last-minute change to the planned itinerary by going on an unofficial walkabout.
Sergeant Stone, I'd rather like to stop here, please. It's market day, I'd like to have a look around.
Minister, I disagree with that. I know it's market day, but there's going to be thousands of people here, and we haven't had the chance to get a team in there to have a look at the place.
I'm sure you're overreacting. It's quite safe.
When the VIP decides to go on an unscheduled walkabout, it causes vast problems for the close protection team. We have not recorded the area. We haven't selected any ERV points, emergency rendezvous points, so we've got to think in our feet.
OK, all stations there. Minister wants to stop at the market. They're not prompting a visit, so be aware. OK, right, stop.
OK, go in, Foxtrot.
A minister going walkabout is a nightmare scenario in close protection. It's unpredictable and not wrecked. But she's paranoid about being smothered by her team of escorts. For a close protection team, everyone is a potential threat. How do they assess the level of threat when surrounded by a crowd, differentiating the attacker from friendly shoppers?
Good morning.
Close protection work on foot is all about drills and formations. These are ever-changing and depend on the nature and pattern of streets, traffic and people. There's never just one position to take up.
If you're going to change direction, please do it slowly because we have to have the close protection team in front of you.
When protecting the minister on Foxtrot, the team needs to think about communication. One member of the close protection team will act as the link man and signal changes in formation using hand and radio communication.
Going right.
Body cover. Never sacrifice security for appearance. BGs in every situation should be within arm's length or within striking distance. They need to blend into the background in any given situation.
On the move.
Good cover plan. Each member of the close protection team has an area of responsibility with overlapping areas of observation and fire. Vigilance. Each man needs three pairs of eyes. One pair for the VIP to ensure where she is, second guessing where she's going next. One pair on the other team members, and yet another pair to keep a vigilant watch for suspicious characters within their arc of responsibility. Close protection work on foot is based on training, drills, and formations. These can be adapted to any given situation.
This formation we're in at the present time is known as the open box formation. We have two guys in point, two guys in the rear, giving us 360 degrees protection. Myself and the personal protection officer for the VIP. This is great. It allows the VIP access to the public. It's good for image, but it is very, very poor for security.
Sarah! Ah!
Get down! Although this formation is great for the VIP's image, it allowed an attacker to get into the inner core of the close protection team. This formation we're in at the moment is known as the closed box formation. VIPs don't like it because they can't be seen by the public. It's very good for security, but...
Grenade! Get down!
If someone throws a grenade or an explosive device into the close protection team, we have no option but to get the VIP in the ground and cover her with her bodies.
This formation is the one preferred by both the VIP and the close protection team. It's an easily adaptable formation and gives us good all-round arcs of fire. We've got a point man who's able to watch to the front and down the left-hand and right-hand side of any crowd. We've got myself positioned beside the VIP, offering personal protection to her, but also able to observe to my left and to my right. To my right, I've got John Mack covering to his right and also offering protection to the VIP if necessary. On the left-hand arm of the V, we have Johnny. He's watching to the rear and also watching down the left-hand flank of the formation. On the right-hand arm of the V, we have Pete. He can also watch to the rear and watch down the right-hand side of the formation. This formation allows us to withstand a simultaneous attack from both sides.
When a VIP is on public walkabout, the close protection team rely upon their training to expect the unexpected. When Margaret Thatcher decided to go foxtrot on a visit to Australia, she left herself open to a possible attack. Her bodyguard struggled to keep the crowd in check, and their only option was to keep the Prime Minister moving by forming a protective closed box around her. In this case involving Princess Diana, notice the quick, incisive actions of her royal protection officers in putting down an attack. But not every VIP is quite so lucky. During a visit to Wales, Deputy Prime Minister John Prescott was without a protection team and had to take matters into his own hands.
Yeah, Roger, copy that.
As the minister and her aide walk back to their vehicles, a small group of people along a side street are keen to meet her. So what if the close protection team have to deal with an unarmed assailant who attempts to attack the minister? Watch for the bad guy in black.
Let's go. Mobile one, move to the bottom end of Freedom Road for pickup. Over. Okay, lads, move.
Stand by, over. Stand by.
Cutting down this small alleyway. Johnny's observing everything in front of us. He notices a crowd of people in a small recess to the left-hand side. What are they doing there? Why are they there? Are they a threat? He will immediately notify me and the rest of the team of this. As we walk up towards this small crowd of people, they call the minister over. She's very up for this. She likes meeting the public. As we go up to meet the crowd, I call a close protection team in. In a closed box formation.
Okay, stand by all stations, just close in.
Two of the guys will remain facing outwards, giving us cover. Myself, plus John Mack in this instance, will face the crowd, so we've got our eyes on the crowd at all time. When this drunk tries to grab the minister, I will immediately step in front of him, protect the minister. John Mack will then aggressively move this guy out of the road and deal with it. As he's doing that, I am moving the minister down the road into a safe area with all around protection, and I will call for the vehicles to come up.
Next up on Minister Long's tour of Mostovia is a formal press briefing with members of the state media. It's set in the grounds of a Mostovian country estate.
$14.50, entrance to the venue for the press conference.
The venue for the press briefing has been wrecked by Eddie and his team, and they have deemed it a suitable, secure location.
Okay, principal arrives, out the car, lead the principal through this way.
The close protection team's preferred choice for the briefing is indoors to minimise any potential threat. But for Minister Long and her press aide, the gardens of a country retreat seem the perfect location for an ideal photo opportunity.
It's such a lovely day outside today, I think I'd like to have it in the garden, if you don't mind.
Well, I strongly object to that, Minister. We've arrived at the location for the press conference. I have selected an indoor venue. The Minister has rejected this. She wants to do it in the open air. This is a nightmare scenario for the close protection team.
With Eddie overruled on the choice of location for the press briefing, the close protection team are again venturing into a less than ideal situation.
I have been in your lovely country of Mostovia now for the last couple of days, and I met yesterday with your president.
Open and exposed to woodland, it's the perfect location for multiple attacks. So what if a sniper managed to break through the outer cordon of security and is set up to take out Minister Long? And what if a close-quarter assassin has infiltrated the press pack? Stone and his team are about to face a dual attack assassination attempt. Firstly from the sniper, and then followed up by the stooge and the press pack. Minister, at the last moment, her aide moves forward and inadvertently takes the sniper's bullet. As the press pack panic, Mac and Pete's fast reactions take out the second assassin.
The close protection team have their weapons drawn. As they bring the weapon up into the aim, they will take that extra half a second to make sure that they have the correct target before squeezing that trigger. So it is very, very important that you have that control and don't panic when you're taking that shot, so that you can make sure that the person you hit is the person you want to hit.
But in our fictitious mission, the press conference went without a hitch, and Minister Long is to end her day as a guest of President Gorin at his private retreat. It's here where Stone and his team will hand over the British Minister's security to their Mostovian counterparts for the remainder of her trip. Before the handover, the Secret Services would usually sweep Minister Long's room in order to detect any bugs or explosive devices.
A unit.
It's a transmitting bug, transmitting at a few megahertz, has a range of about 200 or 300 meters. Now disarmed.
Oh, Well, sadly, we start with the news that early this morning, a major bomb
exploded. It may have been a small bomb by IRA standards, but it demonstrated a new level of terrorist sophistication.
Where Mrs. Thatcher and other Conservative leaders are staying.
By placing the device between floors 5 and 6, the maximum damage was assured.
A classic oversight during the annual Conservative Party conference in 1984 occurred when security services failed to conduct an effective sweep of a hotel. This allowed the IRA to pre-position a bomb with devastating consequences. Today, lessons from the Brighton bombing have been learnt, and security services take no chances when a VIP is in town. Checking everything from hotel rooms, television sets, drainage systems, and building electrics. In fact, it's common practice to sweep a whole city or town. Ian Curtis works for a company who manufacture high-tech equipment that sweeps for bugs.
In any environment, there are basically two types of bug. One is a bug that transmits using wireless technology. The other type is a bug that's actually hardwired into somewhere. In other words, it has no transmission. It could be listening through a wall. It could be wired to your electrical sockets with a tape recorder downstream. So to counteract that, there are basically two types of technology. There is this unit here, which is, in simple terms, a radio detector. This will very rapidly sweep the entire radio band and will lock on to the strongest signal in any particular room. One of these sort of devices here is an active bug. But you can actually hear that transmitted now. That's locked on to that strongest signal in the room. The other type of devices are electrical devices. This unit here picks up where two different types of metal actually connect. So this unit will penetrate to about 6 inches of concrete and about 30 centimeters of wood. So even if there's electronic devices buried in there, this unit will let you know there is a presence of an electronic device. And this one, you physically move along all the walls and sweep the room.
Our SAS team have come to the end of their protection duties. Minister Long will now be handed over to the Mostovian security forces. After briefing his Mostovian counterpart, Stone remains unconvinced of their security measures. He relays his fears back to the rest of the team.
Okay, lads, these guys are Mickey Mouse, yeah? I'm not very happy leaving her in the arcade at all, yeah? They're not close protection team, all they are is...
In our fictitious scenario, he then decides to raise his security concerns with his bosses back in the UK.
Cheers, boss. Bye. Just as much as we expected, mate. Diplomatically, she wants to be left alone here to have a chat without us being around. So we've got to leave her here. We're going to pull off back into the town.
But basically, she's left here for 40 hours under M-clowns. Yep.
Yeah.
Eddie Stone and his team have been ordered to stand down against their wishes. They feel that leaving Minister Long's personal safety in the hands of the Mostovians is a grave mistake.
It's the day after tomorrow.
Good.
We've got another full day, right up until... Excellent.
With a full schedule, it's rare for the minister to get to bed before the early hours. But tonight, there is absolutely no chance of her getting any rest.
Shut it!
Where the hell are you?
Shut it! You wanted to meet the MLA? Here we are.
Eddie's worst fears about local security are confirmed, as the MLA, a rebel terrorist cell, overpower the guards and kidnap the minister. They also abduct the Mostovian president and his aide. Within hours, the team are back on the case.
Hello.
But in a new role, counter-terrorism.
Yep.
And what are the do's and don'ts of surviving when taken hostage? There are no hard and fast rules about hostage situations. They can be over in minutes or go on for years. John McCarthy and Terry Waite, perhaps Britain's most famous hostages, spent a total of 10 years between them, cramped in cellars and dark rooms around Beirut before their safe return in 1991. It's an experience that leaves scars, but generally, the longer it goes on, the better the chances of survival. It's in the first few minutes and hours that the hostage runs the greatest risk of being killed. At this acute stage of a kidnap, even the most organized terrorists will be jumpy. As a cabinet minister, it's highly likely that Miss Long will have had hostage survival training. This includes simple guidelines to staying alive.
The single most important thing, head and shoulders above everything else, is the crucial what to do in those crucial first few minutes or hours. If you lose control, if you lose it during that time, it's going to be very, very dodgy. Nerves are raw, everybody's feelings are on edge. And I think that sometimes people will find themselves in a position where they've lost control by being irritable or angry. And that's extremely dangerous because hostage takers don't like hostages who get angry.
So, it's important to stay calm and encourage others to do the same. Passive cooperation is the key, and you should stay alert.
To remain alert is really the name of the game for the person who's taken hostage. To learn as much as you possibly can about your captors, to learn where you are, to find out what their motivation is, those things are really important. If you put in a dark cell and there's no light getting in, you can become very confused because of the sensory deprivation, because you don't know what's day and what's night. You can bet your bottom dollar that the captors are not going to help you with that by dishing you up breakfast regularly at 8 a.m. and dinner at 6.
Forget about home comforts. They may come later, but you should prepare yourself mentally for a long, drawn-out ordeal.
Says,
it's not long before the minister's predicament hits the headlines. The Mostovian Liberation Army, or MLA, use the media to make their demands known. The pressure is on both the Mostovian and British governments to get something done. Back in Mostovia, the team meet with a local intelligence officer.
I'm going to try and find out numbers of people involved, how motivated they are, how likely they are to carry out any threats which they've given, what weapons they've got, transport, any little piece of information that we can gather from this guy, we will try and get.
Pretty vicious. They've been pretty vicious.
They get the most basic of briefings. From security cameras, three of the terrorists have been identified. They're known to the secret police. Biographies and photographs are supplied, but where they're being held is anyone's guess. The hostages are being moved regularly. This is a familiar tactic used in urban environments that makes it almost impossible to pin the terrorist down. But the security tapes reveal more than just the number of terrorists and the weapons they used.
What puzzles me is how they actually got through the perimeter, you know? I mean, there could have been any perimeter defence there, you know?
Well, clearly, it's an inside job. The team will return to the chateau to look for more clues, but they won't be sharing any more intelligence with the local forces. From now on, they need to hold their cards close to their chest.
The whole thing stinks.
On the move again for the third time in as many days, the hostages are being taken to a deserted army barracks. However, there is one crucial piece of information that Eddie has shared with local security.
You all right, Minister?
The minister is a diabetic and has only a limited supply of medicine.
We need insulin desperately.
something the terrorists were unaware of until now. The minister's diabetes is real enough. Making the most of an illness is a tactic that can help secure release or force the terrorists to give their location away.
She's in a bad way.
Insulin is a difficult medicine to come by in our war-torn Mostovia. On Eddie's advice, the pharmacies are being watched. It pays off. A young woman recognized as the sister of one of the terrorists is caught buying medicine. She's followed and leads the security forces straight to the barracks. The hostages and terrorists are now trapped in a siege scenario. The site is locked down, perimeters established by the local police, and lines of communications are opened up between the terrorists and the authorities.
We ask you if you could just give us a little bit more time.
It's a standoff. The 1972 Munich Olympics, a games devastated by an appalling act of terrorism. 9 kidnapped Israeli athletes were killed by the Black September Group when an ill-planned police assault went disastrously wrong.
17 hours of bargaining had failed. The report's constant refrain is that nothing else was possible but a last determined effort to save the hostages by force.
It was to change the way governments deal with terrorists forever. And in Britain, the SAS created the Counter-Terrorism Wing. With their distinctive black kit, in the regiment they are called the team. At any given time, a squadron is on standby to deal with anti-terrorism and rescue. It's divided into 2 units, sniper and assault teams. On arrival, the squadron move into a holding area close to the siege building. This is home until the operation is over. Their black kit is always to hand.
This is the equipment used in an assault team, commonly known as the black kit. There are good, lightweight, strong, robust boots. There are fireproof overalls. In the sleeves, you'll have a slot, which is an identification mark. Because obviously, once you get dressed up, it's very, very difficult to recognize individuals. S10 respirator. This comes with a filter. This filter helps you against flash when you're going into the building. Your canister or filter. These keep out any gas, CS gas, and smoke. A pair of lightweight gloves. Nice and flexible, thin, so you can feel safety catches, triggers. Belt kit, ops waistcoat. Knife, it's not for stabbing people with, it's for cutting ropes. If you're abseiling, you get hung up. Kevlar helmet, helps protect you. Get a shot in the head, you're dead. Also stops people from battering you with an iron bar or something as you run into the room, which obviously can be quite painful. Kevlar body armour with front and back ceramic plates. This weighs about 25 to 30 pounds. You wear all this equipment, shin guards, knee pads. Underneath that, you've got fireproof underwear, fireproof vest. But this kit can become too restrictive. You've still got to have that fluid motion, so you've got your balance, speed of movement. By personal safety, I'd rather be quick on my feet than bundled up like a knight in armour and end up dead. OK, John, get the paper down. No chance getting a bet on here.
There has been a flurry of intelligence gathering. It's the commanding officer that will give the order to proceed with an assault, but it's down to Eddie to brief the team.
I believe that there is a leak further up the system in this job. Just the way things are panning out, the whole thing was done too easily as far as I'm concerned.
OK, let's run through it from the top.
For ease of communication, hostages are referred to as Yankees and numbered according to their importance. So, Yankee 1, Yankee 2, Yankee 3 and Yankee 4.
Remember the minister. She's our most important target. Run through the X-rays.
Terrorists are X-rays. Again, a simple way of making sure everyone is singing from the same song sheet.
X-ray 1-2. This is the top guy. He's definitely ex-military. This guy knows his cookies. X-ray 1-3, Slobodan. 24 years old, very committed to the cause. 1-4. He was part of the BG team for the president. But he never planned this operation on his own. This came from higher up as well. There's another terrorist, X-ray 1-5, who we don't have a picture of at the present time. So be very aware, be one of them, he might try and act as a sleeper amongst the hostages. We're trying hard at the present time to get some pictures of him. Sniper team's out at the moment.
Snipers don't just shoot people. They also provide vital information on the terrorists, the hostages, and their movements.
Stand by. Sierra 1, activity on target.
The building is ringed by observation posts, each with a clear line of sight. The snipers are blacked out to reduce the chances of being spotted. They operate in a constant state of readiness. Stagging on, in four-hour shifts, the sniper team eat, sleep, and even go to the toilet at the OP. They will not leave until the mission is over. The building is color-coded for a quick way to ascertain who is where and when. For our team, front and back are white and black, respectively. The right-hand side is red and the left green.
If you suddenly have a terrorist appearing at one of the windows, let's take this one here. We know he's on black. He's on the first floor. And he's at the second window. So the sniper watching that position would report back to control, X-ray 1-2, seen at black 1-2. Black 1-2 being the first floor, second window across.
To the outsider, it can sound like a whole new language.
That's X-ray 1-3 looking out of the window. Second X-ray in white 1-8 with a balaclava on, identified. Carrying along.
And in case you missed it,
that's X-ray 1-3 looking out of the window. Second X-ray in white 1-8 with a balaclava on, identified. Carrying along.
For the hostages, a siege is quite a different prospect from a kidnap. Previously, the terrorists had been in control. Now the security forces have them contained. But the terrorists could easily decide to sacrifice someone to prove they mean business. Sim Harris has a good idea what it feels like to be in that room. He was among the hostages rescued by the SAS from the Iranian embassy in 1981. That's what we saw on the live TV coverage. What went on inside the building up to then was a six-day ordeal.
We seemed to go from one crisis to the next, and as you got to one crisis and got through it, it might be a deadline. You know, if we don't receive X in certain time, then we'll kill a hostage. And as you go through each deadline, there's enormous relief. I mean, we had one where there was that they wanted a broadcast made of their demands. And it took seemingly hours to negotiate and eventually get this broadcast made. But once the broadcast was made, I mean, I can't tell you what the atmosphere was like. There was literally hostages hugging hostages, terrorists hugging terrorists, and terrorists hugging hostages, because you form this sort of those of you inside against those of you outside.
In our scenario, the terrorist behaviour is getting more erratic. And their demands increasingly unrealistic.
Just give us a little bit more time. We're working on it as quickly as we can.
that kind of money, $40 million.
As the negotiations deteriorate, our team are forced to prepare an IA, or an immediate action.
As soon as the team arrives, you must be able to brief them on an immediate action plan in case they start killing the hostages before you are ready with a deliberate assault plan.
Pete, entry man, Johnny, number two, John Mark, number four, mate, yeah?
Obviously, what you're looking for is to do a deliberate assault. Then you're in charge, and they haven't started killing any of the hostages.
Remember the minister? She's our most important target to get out. The rest of them, pay some money, take their chances, right?
With the immediate action plan, they've already started killing the hostages. So it's speed which is essential here. You've got to get into that building quickly, because the longer you delay, the more of the hostages are going to get killed before you get in there.
OK, our entry point is going to be through red in this doorway here. We're going to have about 200 metres to leg it. OK, once the room's secure...
So let's say things do suddenly go bad. What if, for example, hostages have been shot and the squadron go in? What would an immediate action look like?
Let's go!
Stand by, stand by!
Okay.
It's vitally important that even though you're moving very, very quickly, you mustn't forget your basic tactics of building clearing. You must cover each other down the corridor. When they get to the stronghold where the hostages are being kept, they must make sure that the rest of the team is with them before they go through that door.
None of this happens by accident. These drills have to be rehearsed, re-rehearsed, and rehearsed again. Of course, it helps if you have the right tools.
MP5, extending stock. 9mm, very, very accurate weapon. Goes over your shoulder, clips on, holds the weapon nice and firmly against your body. You have to use your hand. Two 30-round magazines. Cocked and locked at all times. On the front, a torch. Where you point that torch is where your bullets is going to end up. Remington 870 Magnum shotgun, 5 rounds, piece of bungee in the end. This is carried by the person who's going to open the doors. He'll wear it over the top of his body armour and his ops waistcoat on the piece of bungee so it's nice and tight against the side of his body. When he comes up to the door, he has to blow the hinges off, grabs the shotgun, pulls it out, bang, door open. Lets it go, and it'll immediately fall back into his side.
Specialist ammunition called Hatton shells are used with this weapon. But of course, there are slightly cruder ways of achieving the same thing.
One of my favourite pieces of kit, once again for entry, door entries. Take this dynamic hammer, hold it, give it a good swing, right by the lock, and it will cave the door in. Stun grenades, flashbangs, lots of various names, but they all do the same thing. A loud bang doesn't harm anybody, but it will distract the terrorists long enough for us to get into the room to do the business. 6 Sauer P228, 9mm semi-automatic pistol. This is your secondary weapon, and it's carried in your holster. If you have a stoppage in your main weapon, you'll immediately get down on your knee. Draw this weapon and engage the target. Hopefully, by that time, the backup man will be in. You can be taking out any terrorists in the room.
Run! OK. Find the back! Find the back! Quick!
Plastic cuffs. Plastic cuff everyone. Treat them all as hostile until you get them into the open where they can be ID'd.
We train in this kit for months and months, so that it becomes like a second skin to us.
Another star secured!
So that when we get called out on an operation, we can do the business without feeling restricted.
The immediate action is an emergency assault. The reality in our siege scenario, now into its third day, is a bit more mundane. As fear gives way to boredom, it's important for our hostages' well-being that they keep themselves occupied.
It is essential to move around as much as possible. You have to take as much exercise as your surroundings will afford. Sometimes the guards will prevent you from doing that because they know it's giving you some incentive to carry on. It's actually something which is keeping your morale up. They don't want that.
Mental exercise is important too. Hostages have been known to write entire novels in their head just to keep occupied. If they do allow themselves to become depressed by the situation, they won't care what happens to them. And if they don't, the terrorists certainly won't. Getting captors to value a hostage's life is the key. This can be done by creating a good rapport.
Do you have family?
I have family.
It's quite a good idea if you have any photographs on you, which often people carry, and show photographs of your family. You want to remind the captors that you are a human being.
But it's crucial not to try too hard and become over-friendly.
There's a very fine line to be drawn, because as soon as the guard discovers that he's being manipulated, then he will punish.
At the Iranian embassy siege, it was the terrorists themselves who were keen to strike up a rapport.
At one point, they explained in quite some detail, they got maps out and explained why they were doing what they were doing and how they'd been persecuted and all that sort of thing. And, you know, you do find yourself agreeing with them.
In our fictitious scenario, the planning continues. They find a building similar in layout and run through a deliberate assault. With each passing hour, they refine their rescue mission.
We know you're keeping an eye on us. We know you're planning.
As a veteran of many actions, the terrorist leader is wary of allowing anyone getting too close to the building. Even a civilian delivering food could spot something the snipers have missed. But he's confident that he's going to get his way and the siege will soon be over.
I want to know as soon as the transport is arranged. Until that time, we will have some food.
Some quiet.
The terrorists even allow team member John McAleese to assume the role of pizza delivery man.
Still can't see anybody, don't know what's happening. I'm just having a look around, see what I can see. Can't see, I can see me out the window.
A potential flashpoint. The snipers are ready to take out any terrorist who might make a move on Mac.
Danger-wise, it could be dangerous because you could be actually taken as hostage, but that's the chance you take. That's what you get paid for. Somebody's got to do it.
Inside the building, all is not well between the hostages and the terrorists.
Just back off! Shut it and down!
The Mostovian president has become abusive towards the terrorists, oblivious to the consequences.
That's enough!
The minister's aide, meanwhile, has a whole different take on the situation.
For God's sake, don't you think you've said enough? They are human beings.
Far from feeling resentment towards the terrorists, he's begun to see things from their point of view. It's the first signs of a condition that gets its name from a hostage incident in the early 70s in Sweden. Stockholm syndrome. Long-term hostages can become very attached to their captors, looking up to them rather than fearing or despising them.
And of course, the reason for this is survival. It is an unconsciously motivated, very powerful survival defense mechanism. That's what it's for. But this, of course, can lead to remarkable relationship forming. People will get married after the hostage situation is over and done with. People will wait for the other one to come out of prison in order to be able to get to them. Having shared that moment, that very intimate moment, is a very powerful thing.
I followed the let's save myself, let's be, you know, the Stockholm syndrome, where you become very sympathetic to your captors and their requirements, and you're actually arguing on their behalf.
Get in, sit down. You're going, you're staying.
Being held hostage produces many conflicting feelings. Through it all, keeping yourself respect by controlling those emotions is vital.
People who are accustomed to have a lot of control over their minds and their feelings tend to do better. They can actually lose the confusion, lose the nightmare, if they go into themselves, if they actually retreat into the relative safety of their own minds. I mean, after all, a captor can't actually take control of your mind.
We have four hostages. You know they all don't matter to us. We know you are watching.
We know you're keeping an eye on us. We know you're planning.
The terrorists are getting impatient. They know that the Mostovian government have no intention of meeting their demands. The negotiator knows there is no way out for them, but he's going to keep them talking for as long as possible.
Wait, come on.
The media and TV crews are out in force. The pressure for a quick, clean conclusion is mounting.
Okay, do I look okay?
The long-term effects of being a hostage can be very mild, almost non-existent, or they can be very severe. And that can be physical and psychological, a combination of the two. The most important point I'd like to make here is the one that you wouldn't expect me to make, and that is that it can have a very positive influence on people. We mustn't fall into the trap of thinking that trauma, or the trauma of being a hostage, will necessarily lead to a negative end result. That's just not true, not in my experience anyway. But you have to work hard, you know, towards making it into a positive. Most of all, of course, the person themselves. They have to be very courageous and work hard. They're never going to be the same people again. They've learned something about themselves, but if they can actually feel good about having survived as a hostage, then that is a great feather in their cap, and they can go into the future feeling, I suppose, better prepared.
On your feet! Off!
Move! Stand by, stand by. That's activity on target. Shouting from the target.
Move! Move! Now! Gonna start now? Now!
They remove the Mostovian president and put a gun to his head. A chilling warning is issued.
If you don't believe how serious we are, listen to this.
It's the green light for the team to go in. In the next episode of SAS Survival Secrets, speed, aggression, surprise. The assault is on. It only takes minutes to execute, but requires years of training to get it right. We'll introduce you to the infamous killing room techniques. We'll run through what you need to know to survive CQB, close quarter battle. And more than 20 years on, John Mack, the man on the balcony at the Iranian embassy, meets for the first time the hostage whose life he saved.